called for a number of things, and I'll move on to those in a minute. And for those that could view it there, you'll understand and appreciate that prior to that, I wasn't as active in this side of the trade union fight as I should be. So it's been kind of a whirlwind few months, going from no experience whatsoever to actually sitting here and speaking to you all. The motion at the TUC called for a number of things. One of the things was a cross-sector industrial strategy, as well as a just transition programme, which involves all unions that are members working in the industry. And that ensures that workers keep their jobs, utilise the skills, and it's not a case of, Susan mentioned earlier, it's not a case of, well, we need to move the industry, and we're going to lose our roles now. It's about utilising those positions, utilising those workers, because we recognise that there are towns, there are villages, there are cities where whole groups of people, the whole city in fact, rely on things like power stations for a living. And what we don't want to do, and what we can't do, is put those people at risk. So it is about working together for a just transition, it's about working with the trade unions to make sure that happens. We also want to lobby the right to workplace environmental reps. I know that some unions, such as PCS, already have those in place, and I was lucky enough to attend a green forum last year, and it was inspiring. You know, the ideas that were floating around those workshops, what's happening out there already. And I'm actually finished a few ideas for our branches, and I know they don't mind, so thanks for that. And what we've done from there is we've looked to kind of mimic what they're doing. We're not as big a union as they are, so we're not in a position where we can just develop separate reps at the minute, but we're adapting our health and safety reps to incorporate more environmental tasks into their work. The third point is to bring the UK energy system back into public ownership and democratic control. And I think that's a vital part of the motion, because whilst every public support for people, workers on low pay and zero-hours contracts, they're going to have to continue to make choices around the heat homes, or the feed kids, or the travel on the bus to work, or to walk for an hour. And whilst ever profits will call people, elderly people will continue to die within that because they cannot afford to heat their homes. And lastly, the motion called for an aspect of an insulation programme on bricked homes and public buildings to reduce those costs going out for people paying energy bills. And as Susan said, the motion we received unanimous support, which was amazing and actually quite historical, because a few motions in the years before that had been quite contentious. That was quite nice to the leader of that motion. And as a union, again, as Susan pointed out, we support the 1 million climate jobs proposal, from the start, and we've been extremely vocal and active and supportive of the anti-tracking campaigns going on around the country. But after the motion, we knew needed to do more. You can't move a motion like that and put all those millions of trade unionists and just do certain parts. So, as I mentioned, we're looking to expand the remit of our health and safety reps to include some environmental roles. We're also in the process of developing a green newsletter. I've kind of been given the task to take in charge of that. And that's around engaging our members and educating them, and sharing best practice between the branches and the workplace. Because we recognise that a lot of our members, and a lot of people that are in these trade unions don't see the link in what they can do to climate change and the wider impacts that it can have. They don't realise that it could just be a small change that they're making in their lives, which is making sure that they're recycling or using, not using plastic bottles, can make a massive difference overall. Significant. And when you look at the big picture of climate change, it can be quite daunting. That's the word I was looking for. To think, well, actually, I can't make a big difference, just about making those steps and building on them. And some of our employers that we work with, we spend a lot of time as trade unionists questioning employers for the bad things that we do. But actually, some of our employers have some fantastic things already in place. Our best is that Basically has recently bought a wind turbine. And they're putting that up, and they're going to be using that to generate electricity. Premier Foods nationally have trained some of their workforce in environmental issues, albeit from an employer's perspective, but I think it's a start, and they're actually putting money and time and resources into looking at environment and thinking what they can do to change and lower their carbon footprint. And my background is working for Greggs, and for a long time it's not been a health and safety department, it's been a health, safety and environment department, and their environmental charities in the shops, so looking at how to reduce the energy that's in the shops and the bakeries. So from this, we're looking, and this is a very early stages at the minute, but we're looking at holding a conference towards the end of the year and inviting these employees to the conference. We'll have proposals to put to them, to share best practice, what they're doing and what others can do, so that we can work together going forward as a trade union and the employees that we represent with our workforce in, to negotiate specific collective environmental reps, you know, championing those employees going into the jobs, and to shape our industry to be better going forward. And actually it's a really exciting time, you know, we do speak about climate change and it is very worrying. Actually, I've seen these employers and these members kind of sparking that interest. That's quite exciting, and we need to build on that. And again, as I mentioned, it's vitally important that our members recognise and understand the link between trade unions and climate change, and also what they can do to be involved in. After all, anything that affects ourselves, our families, and our communities, it's got to be a trade union issue. That's all we're doing.
Comments in terms of the realities for our communities on the front line. There are some key fundamental principles that have to shape about how we work on climate change. They're actually principles that are already at the heart of the trade union movement, and they're instinctively understood by every trade union comrade here. And they are what makes the trade role of the trade union movement so vital in ensuring that international solidarity in the climate justice movement means more than just hollow words. So the first and foremost question I always ask, who are we accountable to? Who is this movement accountable to? So for too long, climate change has largely been framed by individuals, organisations, and of course governments, who have been anchored by their own political and economic interests. Those people who shape the climate discourse have largely been from the global north. That's why we have groups still peddling this false idea that a 50-50 chance of keeping temperatures below 2 degrees is a safe goal. One only needs to look at the extreme heat waves, superstorms, hurricanes, killer floods, droughts, that to look at the reality of just 1 degree warming. Hundreds of thousands of people losing their lives, millions of people whose lives and livelihoods and their homes are being devastated. And of course, those that are facing the worst impacts aren't even saying that the 1.5 degree threshold is a safe threshold. The actual call from frontline communities is 1.5 to barely stay alive. This is the threshold we've got when scientists tell us that impacts in the global south will start to increase, will start to trigger and spin up an even greater control. And as we've already heard, even the most optimistic of projections based on the UN climate agreement that was made in Paris in 2015 have us temperatures heading to at least 3 degrees, up to 5, and some even predicting 6, 7 and even more by the end of the century. And governments in the global north, including our own government, we all like to claim that they recognise how serious climate change is, and yet it's these very same governments that are refusing to do their fair share of effort based on historical emissions. So they're responsibility for causing the climate crisis. So you've heard probably these figures before. Japan is offering to put like 1/10 of its fair share. The US, even under Obama, the so-called climate leader, is only willing to do 1/5 of its fair share. And of course, the European Union is only offering a fifth. And that doesn't include all the huge financial transfers that are needed for the poorest to be able to deal with the climate impact and develop quickly. For the UK to do its fair share, its target must be closer to about 90% reduction by 2030. That is far, far from what is being offered by anybody on the table. And we're told, don't worry, because climate change is something that affects all of us, we're all in it together. And I've heard countless times, well-meaning people often use that analogy, and it's an analogy that grates on me so much, about the Titanic, that we're all on the Titanic, and it hit the proverbial iceberg. And it's absolutely right that, of course, the climate change will affect everyone, and the reality. But the reality is, of course, that the cities of rich industrialised countries, primarily in the global north, are on the Titanic, but they're still on the tip. They're sipping cocktails, listening to the orchestra. They're hoping for some technological miracle is going to save them. And it's in the hold where you see the poorest, the most marginalised, black, brown people from the global south, but also the poorest in the global north. And they're already drowning. And when they try and escape, they actually find that the holds are welded shut. So the second thing that's really important for us is to actually start telling truth to power. And the reality is, of course, that 10% of the world's population is responsible for 50% of global emissions. And we have to take responsibility because we are all part of that 10%. It is us in the global north which drives so much of emissions. Because the poorest 50% of the world are only responsible for about 10% of emissions. Secondly, and what's really important, is that we have to stop talking about climate change as an environmental issue. It is not an environmental issue. It's fundamentally one of the deepest and most political issues that faces us. It's fundamentally an issue of racial and economic justice. And when we look at climate change, do we look and we start to unpack it? When we think about forced migration or gender and racial injustices, or when we think about economic inequality, extreme weather, extractivism, systems collapse, you name it, all of them are of course a system. There are symptoms of a system. It's a neocolonial and neoliberal system which sees large parts of the world as sacrifice zones so that the global north can continue consumption, continue its inequitable growth model and its unsustainable model. And it's that same system that lies at the heart of the climate crisis. Because it's actually, the climate crisis is largely predicated on the idea at the moment that the people of the global south can be sacrificed to maintain business as usual. So that's why one of the most important things our movement must do is to stop saying, take action on climate change. It means nothing. It is an empty slogan. Second thing we must stop doing is stop putting the white polar bear on the white iceberg and saying that is climate change. The climate change, because what that does, it is invisibilizes the realities of the climate crisis. It denies the experience of those people already facing climate injustice on the global, facing climate injustice. But it also includes one of the greatest spins that are being perpetuated, that the world has either up to 2050 or to the end of the century to keep temperatures below from reaching 1.5 Kelvin. The reality is that the only pathways that exist to that kind of time frame require a huge amount of negative emissions. That's technology to suck carbon out of the atmosphere so that we can continue to pollute. And they range from the mad and bad to the ones that sound on the surface quite benign. But even they require huge amounts of land to be able to do it, bioenergy. And no guessing who will pay the price for that. It's the poorest in the world who will be forced off those lands. It will be the food production which will be hit. And it also, of course, delays transforming our global economy. The reality is we only have a decade or more if you want to keep temperatures seriously below 1.5. So what does that mean for us? So of course it means saying no to fossil fuel steering. And of course the work that the amazing anti-fracking communities and resistance is doing is essential to that. And it's great to hear the Labour Party committing themselves to say no fracking in the UK. That is a real step forward. But also, we must also stand alongside those communities around the world who are resisting fossil fuel extraction. But standing alongside them also must mean more than saying no to fossil fuels. Because our movement must be as committed to actually also tackling energy poverty. It's no good saying to the 1.3 billion people who don't have access to energy, or the 2.3 billion people who don't have access to clean cooking, it's okay, you don't have the right to the same dignified life that we do in the name of the climate crisis. Actually, it means we have to talk about energy and energy needs of the poor. So we have to, yes, talk about decarbonising our energy system by investing in people's own renewable energy. But it also means we have a responsibility in this country to take on our banks and our corporations. And it's about understanding that the wealth of this country, the wealth that even in the Brexit debate so many are trying to protect, the wealth of the City of London, is predicated on the extractivism industries. That 40% of the largest extractive companies are all based here. That it's our banking system that facilitates financing of extraction all around the world. And that our wealth is based on those revenues, the huge trillion of profits that are racked up by the fossil fuel industry every year. So that means not only do we have to say divest, but we also have to say it is public investment that is going to build the global energy system. It is not private end investment. So we do need to have a centre stage of our demands that energy is a public good. But it also means, of course, tackling the food system, which is responsible for about a quarter of the global emissions. And have you heard all of this mantra before? We can feed the world three times over, yet we plough about 2 billion, 1.5 billion tons of food into the ground. Roughly about a third of all of the food we produce, we plough into the ground. And of course, about just under a billion people are malnourished around the world. And the reason why that happens, of course, is the power of the multinationals. The power of the multinationals who control so much of our planet's resources, our planet's food sources. Just two corporations control 65% of all trade in grain. And that's why, as part of our demands, we also have to take on the multinationals. And that means, again, a legally binding treaty that holds companies responsible for their actions and theirs of the supply chain. But the most important thing I think we have to do, and why I was so happy to be able to invite here, is to be able to have a vision for the future. It's no good simply saying it's about the climate crisis. We have to have a vision for the future, a vision that is an alternative to this neocolonial neoliberal model, where it's the free market, privatisation and corporate control of resources that's provided as put forward as the only way that we're going to tackle the climate crisis. But it means also recognising that just as we did against the great struggles against colonialism and imperialism, when extracting the resources of the global south and slave labour from the global south was part and parcel of the labour movement's own internal priorities, we have to now get to the same place again. So we must locate our movement in that proud tradition, and that's why the trade union movement is so important in that. Because it can connect the fight for workers' jobs here, for climate here, for migrant rights and workers' rights here, with the same fights globally. Because if we, in the interest of our own economic nationalism, are willing to throw the rest of the world under the wheels, then we will have failed, not just only as a climate movement, but as a trade union movement. Because the very basis of our movement is we are internationalists. Thank you.